Got several places we're going to look this morning. If you can turn to Isaiah chapter 9 and Isaiah chapter 7. That clue. We're also going to look in Luke chapter 1. I think you'll be familiar with all the scriptures this morning, except for maybe one. Isaiah chapter 7. It is the greatest story ever told. Amen. Do you know that? Don't ever lose sight of it's still the greatest story that's ever been told. And it's not just a story, it's true. And it's truth. And He is truth. Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14 says, "Therefore the Lord Himself shall give you a sign. Behold." I love that word. It means stop and look. "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Of course, you know which means God with us. Church, I could just stop there and think, aren't you glad that He's God with us? He's not a God of wood and stone that some man has carved or created or poured out of precious metal. That He's a God with us. Not was with us. He is with us. He's still Emmanuel. Turn the page. Isaiah chapter 9. Hallelujah. In verse 4. Church, if you'll just ever get a hold of what it means that the Word of God became manifest. John chapter 1 verse 14 says, "And the Word became manifest and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Man, if that'll ever click, what we have. Isaiah chapter 9 verse 4. Says, "For you," the Y there in my Bible is capitalized. It's talking about Him. Hundreds of years before the Word became flesh, the prophet Isaiah saw it. Says, "For you have broken the yoke of this burden." Somebody this morning right now needs to know that the yoke has been destroyed. That you don't have to walk under the heavy burden. The yoke has been destroyed. "And the staff of His shoulder and the rod of His oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood. But this shall be with burning and with a fuel of fire." The "of" there actually means fuel for the fire. "For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon His shoulder. And His name shall be called Wonderful. Counselor. The mighty God. The everlasting Father. The Prince of Peace. Of the increase of His government and peace, there shall be no end. And upon the throne of David, upon the kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice, from hereafter even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Something I want you to see is the increase of His government. It is increasing, not decreasing, through time. What He started has not ended. It's still in motion. Luke chapter 1. In verse 26, it says, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. This is the fulfillment of the great sign of Isaiah chapter 7. And the angel came in to her and said, Hail, you that are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at the saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said to her, Fear not, Mary. For you have found favor with God. And behold, there it is again. And behold, you shall conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. Church, listen. He shall be great. And shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary to the angel, How shall this be? It wasn't a question of doubt. It was a, I believe you. How is it going to happen? You know, when the angel came to the parents of John the Baptist, his father had a howl of doubt that caused him to be struck dumb until after the baby was born. That's not what happened with Mary. She said, How is this going to happen? And the angel answered and said to her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon you, and the power, listen to me, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow you. Therefore also, the holy thing which shall be born of you shall be called the Son of God. Can I read one more verse that I've never seen the context quite like this? 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3. The verse will be familiar. You've heard it many, many times from me. It's talking about the last generation, the falling away church, the apostate generation. In verse 5 of 2 Timothy chapter 3, it says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. What's the next words? From such, turn away. Having a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof, from such, turn away. Heavenly Father, today I love you. Lord, even now I feel the presence of that magnificent Spirit. The preacher, the teacher, the comforter, and the paraclete. Lord, be with us today. Lord, let our words be your words. Let the message be your message. Lord, let those who have ears, let them hear what you would say to your church. And we'll be careful to thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. For unto us a child is born, unto you a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Come this morning to talk about this Jesus that we celebrate this season of the year. I come to challenge the church. I come to speak into the hearts and lives of people, to bring a message of revival, to cause you to think. The last thing in the world the church needs is another cookie cutter routine Christmas Sunday message. It is the greatest story ever told. The day that a virgin conceived a child and was made manifest in human flesh was the greatest event in the creation of man. Never lose sight that a God loved us enough to wrap his son in human flesh and deliver him to a world to be the ultimate sacrifice, the propitiation for our sin. Propitiation, it means literally the only sacrifice to satisfy the burning anger of God. The only sacrifice. He was the only thing that would do. Church, I want to come by and talk to you just a few moments and remind us, to maybe stir in our spirits, that he didn't come because the world needed another religion. He came because the world needed a Savior. When you reduce Christianity down to just another religion, you've lost sight. And he's lost purpose. And there's nothing to be gained. When he was prophesied by the prophet Isaiah, this wonderful counselor, this mighty God, it talked about and even put it into words that there would be an increase of his government, not a decrease. I understand that at the time of his birth, that his manifestation was not what the world expected. Israel was looking for a conquering king, not a meek and lowly baby. They were looking for someone to deliver them from the Roman hand. They were short-sighted in what was to come. Yes, angels heralded his birth. We know the account of shepherds in the field that the scrolls of the heavens were opened up where legions of angels could sing glory to God in the highest, peace and goodwill towards men. But they didn't tell that peace would come at the highest price. Much like today, they were in situations where God's people were looking for a political solution to a spiritual problem. That hasn't changed. While I, as you well know, believe God has a preference in all things, ultimately, our redemption is spiritual and not political. Of His government, of His throne, of His reign, there shall be no end. They didn't understand it the week before His passion as it was beginning. He came in riding on a donkey in great procession with worship in the highest, where they were, you know, the Easter account, where they were cutting down the palm branches and throwing their coats even in the road, singing, Hosanna, Hosanna. When days later, the same crowd would cry, Crucify Him. When His power didn't look the way they thought it would look, when His way was not what they were expecting, church, He's still the powerful King. He was a King that came to give. Listen to me. There's things that are serious that I want to address before we get into the power of His advent. He did not come so we could have another religion. I've already told you that. He came because the world needed a Savior. Unto you this day is born in the city of David what? A Savior, which is Christ, the Anointed. Christ means the Anointed. Why did it need to be a Savior, an anointed Savior? Because the Word of God declares that it is the anointing that will destroy the yoke. In this lead up to unto us a child is born, Isaiah prophesied it again. It says, He has broken the yoke. Church, the yoke has been destroyed. It's up to us to understand that. We don't have to walk around under the burden of this world and under the crushing weight of religion. Let me tell you, religion will destroy you. He came to set the captives free, not to put us under a load. He came to be the burden bearer, not to put us in a situation that made life more hard, where we followed all kinds of rules of do's and don'ts. Cans and canes. We know the Word of God has standards, but it's a standard that when you walk under in the power of the Holy Ghost, that He gives you this. It is the sanctifying power of the blood of Jesus and walking in the power of the Holy Spirit that changes you. It's not your will and it's not your ability. It is something that was bought and paid for in the blood of this precious Lamb that became manifest. Church, the church is losing sight of this again. I don't ever mean to be a negative preacher. I mean to be an equipping preacher. And Timothy, Paul's letters to Timothy and other places, and the revelation bears out, and the letters to Thessalonians bear out, that there would come a time where the people of God and the church of God was going to fall away from the things of God. I always thought in my little mind growing up that the apostasy that would be to come would be that the churches would begin to empty out and people would begin to leave, and that it would be a visible exodus from the church, and I'm finding out as time goes on and as I begin to understand the word that the apostate church is sitting on the pew looking back at the pulpit. Sure, some leave, but most stay and just trade the power of the living God for a dead form of religion. I could walk you through quickly. You've heard me mention it before, but there was a time in church history already, that a time that history records as the Dark Ages, where the light of the gospel was nearly extinguished. The Dark Ages were not called the Dark Ages because we didn't have electricity or they ran out of lamp oil. The Dark Ages were called the Dark Ages because the light of the gospel was nearly extinguished from the face of the earth. And what happened? I'll walk you through quickly. What ended it? What ended the Dark Ages? They're never going to teach you in high school. They're never going to give you an account of what changed the world, what the difference was. The difference was the Dark Ages were brought on when religion had taken over the gospel and men became and used it for political power, and the word of God was shut off to the common man. The only even copies of the books were chained shut on altars by Rome. Where having the word of God was a death penalty offense from the church itself. Wycliffe was martyred, burned at the stake. Why? Because he had the audacity to want to translate the word of God into the language of common man. Murdered because of it. Where indulgences, forgiveness for sin, were sold like a commodity at the local house of worship. If you had no money, you were out of luck. If you had enough money, you could live any way you wanted to. Just come pay the price and even have your sin forgiven in advance. Heresy of the highest order. Dead religion. About 400 years ago, a man known today as, of course, he wasn't really wanting out of the church. He just wanted the church to return to the truth of the Word of God. A man named Martin Luther began what is known today as the Protestant Reformation. Go read his 95 theses and you're going to find that 80-something of them you don't agree with in any way, shape, or form. But one declaration nailed to the door in Wittenberg, Germany, changed the world again. He declared once more that the just shall live by faith. And in an instant, I'll call it a miraculous, God-inspired miracle, the light of the gospel burst forth into the world again. That it was no longer about routine and what you could afford and having no word for yourself. That it was about the foundation of the word again, which is faith in the living God. That light brought another man on the scene that you probably heard of him too. You've probably heard of John Calvin. That after Martin Luther declared that the just shall live by faith, John Calvin brought the doctrine of grace back to the forefront again. And the Reformation began to progress through hundreds of years as light began to permeate the darkness again and brought us to a place where a man you've probably heard of again named John Wesley brought us to a place of the doctrine of sanctification, of holy living again. None of these men had the full scope of the gospel yet in their sight. But as the word returned to the people and the Spirit of God began to move on the earth, that they began to walk in the fullness and the power of the gospel again. What am I saying? The men that we don't completely even agree with today, they began to walk in the light that they had. Up until the turn of the last century, and you began to see men like Branham, and more importantly, men like William Seymour, a former slave, a man with no political influence whatsoever in the world that he walked in. Let me tell you something, when you walk in the power of God, today's politics are irrelevant. Did you hear me? When you walk in the power of God, the political oppression that will tell you you can't has to take a back seat to what the power of the living God will do. A blind in one eye, illiterate at the time, freed slave, began to get a hold of the power of the living God, began to learn His word, began to learn to read, began to learn to communicate, and began to put himself in a position of prayer, because of all of just the earnest heart, he began that the word of God began to come alive again and brought the world to a place of Pentecostal, we call it. It's not a word. It's happened on the day of Pentecost. But it is actually what I am bringing you to is what we now today know is what culminated in the Azusa Street Revival in Los Angeles, California, in the early part of the last century, which I believe, and the word bears out, that brought us back to the fullness of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ as was intended. It was the culmination, listen to me, it was the culmination of the Reformation. 400 years it took to dig out of the Dark Ages. In less than 100 years from that point, the gospel exploded all over the world. An unprecedented, listen, first century church hasn't seen, didn't see the explosion of the power of the gospel that the last 100 years have seen. Do you know that? That today, in places like Brazil, in São Paulo, Brazil, one city, there are four times more full gospel believers in one city in Brazil than the entirety of the United States of America. One city. Never mind the country. Argentina, you can tell the same story. All over the continent of Africa, by the hundreds of thousands of people, that the gospel exploded because the light of this wonderful counselor, mighty God, Prince of Peace, and the power of the gospel went into places. Hey, in communist China, where they will still to this day throw you in jail for decades for the power of the gospel. Whenever the power of the gospel, whenever the power of this God made manifest comes into a people, that there is no political oppression that can stop it. The more you stomp it, the more it'll spread. The more you try to extinguish it, the more people will lay down everything they have because they're full of the power of this Savior and of this Holy Ghost that drives them. Even in America, you say, that's Africa. That's South America. That's in New Zealand. That's in China. Listen, right now, any missionary in closed countries will tell you that the testimony all over the Muslim world by the hundreds of thousands are Muslim men and women that begin to seek the truth, and that over and over and over and over and over the testimony is, as I was asleep and suddenly in my sleep a man in white robed and Roman sandaled feet appeared in my room and manifested himself and convinced a Muslim man and woman that are trapped in the steeps of demonic possessed religion that he is the way. And they come out to their families and to their associates that are around them because they have the truth and they're willing to die for it. Even in the United States, since the turn of the last century, tens of millions of men and women and boys and girls have been brought into the kingdom of God because of a culmination of the power of the living God that was brought back to the earth. I believe marked the beginning of the latter rain. No, I got to stop and clarify that. Not the latter rain movement. We're not talking about silly heresies. We're talking about scriptural, prophetic utterance that said that he would give the former rain in abundance and then the latter rain, and that the two would come together, and that he would give the harvest and the rain in the same month. That's how we know that we're at a place of the last days. That's how we know that now is the time that Paul was talking about to Timothy, that the perilous times that we're in the last days. Everything I've just laid out and walked you just briefly highlights of the last 2,000 years of church history has brought us to a place to know that now is the day of the last days that are prophesied, and now is the time where the human race that has had the fullness of the power of the gospel would begin to apostatize. I told you a few weeks back that I believe, and I still believe it, 3 weeks later, I still believe it, that the days of the denominational believer are over. The denominations are not going to lead the way anymore. It's going to be where men and women and of God receive the truth and the power of the Spirit of God again and begin to walk in it in spite of their dead religion that they've been raised in. I know we're at a time because people that used to walk in the fullness of God, organizations like the Assemblies of God, the Church of God, the Pentecostal Church of God, the Church of the Four Square Gospel, I'll deal with us, have traded the power of God for dead religion again. It's called backsliding. What does backsliding look like? What does apostasy look like? I'll tell you what it looks like. It looks like when you begin to see within the ranks of people that have had the fullness of God, they begin to revert to dead liturgical religion. I begin to see it and begin to deal with it. It began to deal with me. I say things that, when I say some things out loud, it disturbs me, not just you. It shakes me to my core, and it's like somebody's got to tell the world that it's still a powerful gospel, that it is still a powerful Jesus, that it is still a powerful Holy Ghost, and I have no interest in liturgical religion. I saw it just last night. It absolutely blew my mind. It may not do a thing for you, but it blew my mind. I just looked up the word. Hey, y'all have to look up words every now and then. You would be amazed what you learn if you just look up a word. Liturgy. L-I-T-U-R-G-Y. Liturgy. I'm bothered by it. When I see credentialed full gospel or evangelical ministers and their children begin to put Facebook pronouncements about the beauty of the season of Advent. That probably doesn't do a thing to you. Probably make you mad that I even bring it up. It makes me want to puke. When I seen 2 years ago people that come out of the same place I came out of begin to talking about the closeness to God they felt the first time that they went and on Ash Wednesday and they placed ashes on their head. They never felt so close to God in all of their life. Then I thought, then you never got saved, you jerk. Come on. You lied to get your credentials. Oh, I mean, I have rattled somebody's cage all the way to the bottom this morning. You're picking on certain churches. No, I'm not. I've walked you through the progression of Martin Luther to John Calvin to John Wesley to William Seymour and beyond. I walked you through. They walked in the light that they had, and they brought us to the culmination of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. And now we have a generation that's walking backwards to dead, dry religion and think they have something when they're apostatizing, when they're leaving the church, when they're falling for a form of godliness. I read last night, liturgy, listen to me, church, listen to what I have to say. Liturgy, L-I-T-U-R-G-Y, definition. The first two words blew my mind. Are you ready for it? A form. I'll read the rest of it, but I read that and I about fell out of the bed. Liturgy. A form. Or formulary. To which public religious worship, especially Christian worship, is conducted. Why did that blow my mind? Gabriel told Mary that what is conceived in you is of the Holy Ghost. He said, the power, listen to me, somebody say power. The power of the Holy Ghost shall come upon you and it shall overshadow you and you shall be with child. How? The Holy Ghost. He said in Acts chapter 1, you shall receive power after that. The Holy Ghost has come upon you and you will be witnesses. That is a willing to be in a place of martyrdom. You shall be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the othermost parts of the earth. And we've reduced him to a form. It says in Timothy, it talked about this perilous times, last days, apostate church. It says they will have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. They'll have the form, but they don't have the Holy Ghost. The power thereof is the Spirit of the God Himself that empowers His church. Unto us a child, a son is given. And to us a child is born. And then government shall be upon His shoulder. of his kingdom, there shall be no end. It says there'll be an increase in his government, not a decrease. Church, while the church is still looking, now we're looking to politics and dead religion. It's one of those things, again, I've made up my mind. I don't care who it makes mad, who it gives pause, who's upset with me, or who just thinks I'm silly. But I'm going to stand against the forms and proclaim the power. I'll never stand for dead, dry religion when you can have a Savior. Whenever you can, I won't be worrying about lighting cute little candles because of the date that it is on the calendar, or maybe that all the flowers on the stage has to be white 50 days after Easter because it's Pentecost Sunday. Let me tell you, if there's no dove on Pentecost Sunday, I don't care what color the flowers is. If there's no fire that falls on Pentecost Sunday, it makes no difference what the calendar says. If there's no Savior, if there's no power, then we are in a situation that we can't get out of. But I got news for you. He is a powerful Jesus. He is a powerful Holy Spirit, and he wants to move in his church today. He wants to work in his people today. You don't have to fall, and you don't have to backslide. You don't have to leave. You don't have to walk through a drudgery where one day is as boring as the next day. That you can have a Spirit of God in you that will illuminate this word, that will cause you to walk in power, that will cause you to stand for truth, that will cause miracles, signs, and wonders to be confirmed in the body of Christ again, and will cause wayward loved ones to walk back in the door where prodigals will come home. It'll be when we have the power, not the form. We have to stand for what's true. Anybody can go through a form. I think you probably have to be my age or higher to even know. But it's paint by numbers, that form. Anybody remember those when you used to buy paint by numbers and everybody thought you were an artist? When you take away the print and the color guide that tells you where to put what color where, you don't have anything. Turns out it wasn't you at all. Turns out you didn't have anything. Just a form. Just a form. Oh, I'm not much into calendar messages. I'm not much into calendar routine. In church, I'm not much into dead religion. And I'm not much into popularity anymore because I figured out if you tell the truth, you're not going to be popular. But if you don't tell the truth, people are going to die. I don't care what church somebody was in. Just get hold of the power. I'm pretty convinced, though, if somebody gets hold of the power, they'll leave the form. And I don't mind telling you, I don't care if that's an AG form, because we've got some forms. We've got some dead religious trash. I'll just say, we need to take the trash out. I don't mind telling you, we just need to take the trash out. I don't care if it's a Southern Baptist form. I don't care if it's a Methodist form, a Catholic form, but when people get full of the power of the gospel and the power of the Spirit, they'll leave the form behind and serve God in strength and in power. And they'll find each other. Church, do you believe it? Why do I say the things and make the stands? But I'll tell you why. Andrea, it's not because of you. Brandon, you can come back and begin to play. Andrea, it's not because of you. Because you're not going to fall for it. You've already been to the well.
Yes.
You've already been in the book.
Yep.
You've already experienced the power.
Right.
And you're not going to fall for it. Mm-mm. Richard, Teresa, Becky, Dale, Lenora, it's not because of you. Because they've come too late. They've come too late to drag you into that junk. Nelda, it's not because of you. Calvin, it's not because of you. You're not going to fall for it because you know what's true. You know what's powerful. Janet, it's because of him. Kat, it's because of him. Calvin, it's because of her. Lori, Chad, Brenda, me. What's sitting between you, Chris and Regina? That's why. Because not to our credit, that generation has not seen the power of revival that my generation has seen. And they're desperately searching for answers. And they're being dragged backwards. It's being brought backwards to where religious form is the order of the day. Because see, when you don't have any power, when you don't have any power, the only things left to draw a crowd is entertainment and form. That's it. Entertainment and form, it's all that's left, Brother Scott, when there's no power. And Billy Graham used to say, every one of us are created with a God-shaped hole. And I believe that. And this generation is looking for something to fill that hole, just like the one before it and the one before it. And somebody has to tell them that you're not going to find it in an Advent calendar or a liturgical schedule. And not in forms and rituals, that you're going to find it when you find the Prince of Peace, the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And when he begins to move in power in your life, church, this church needs a fresh outpouring of the baptism and the Holy Spirit. Don't worry about the church down the street. Don't worry about the preachers talking about liturgical ceremonies. Worry about MAG at 11477 Highway 12 in Orange, Texas needs a fresh outpouring of the power of the Spirit of God. It's in Jerusalem first. It'll never go to Samaria and Judea until it comes to Jerusalem. Has to start in me. It's why we pray every Sunday night. It's why we preach like crazy people. It's why we put things out to the world and you get satanic attack after satanic attack after satanic attack, and you just keep doing it instead of backing off, because we gotta have it. Still, the greatest story ever told. He's still the same. He's still powerful. He's still a Savior. He's still the baptizer. He's still a way. Hey, we sing it, but he's still a way maker. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, It's not just a song that a Nigerian wrote that we enjoy. It's who he is. You will make no place in your life for the deadness of religion if you get the fullness of life. Stand with me this morning. Father, I thank you for your word, for your spirit that delivers. Lord, I thank you for your truth and your power. Lord, I thank you that you're still everything you always have been. That you have not changed any. That you're still a powerful God. Lord, I pray this morning that your words that by your spirit has found lodging in the hearts of men and women. Lord, that the power of the Holy Spirit is even at work now in this house and even by live stream or someone that will even watch later in the week or later in the month, that you use this vessel to bring light into darkness. Lord, change me. Change this house. Move in this place. So that we can see you move in fullness all over this region. And we'll be careful to give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed all over this house. I know that I'm largely speaking to people that are his. But this morning there might be one that even this morning have realized that they just had a form religion, but this morning you want to be to know him in a powerful way, that you want to be brought into the newness of life, a life-changing experience with the power of the living God. That's you this morning. Would you just show me real quickly by uplifted hand? No one's looking around. I'm not going to delay very long, but if that's you this morning, if you're in the house. Okay, for the rest of us this morning, maybe in you personally, still no one's looking around, and you personally today, you've known that I've got to have the fullness of the power of God in my life again. Lord, bring me to a place. Yes, I see your hands all over this house. I see you. That I just want to be, we used to use the term, I just want to be a sold out vessel for God to have his way. That's you across this place. I know we're needing to be reasonably spread out, and we are this morning. So right where you're at, if that's you this morning, would you just lift your hands to heaven? And would you just, that's a universal sign of surrender. That's a universal sign of surrender. And the Bible talks about I'll lift up holy hands to him. If that's you this morning, would you just afresh and anew place yourself with him and say, Lord, in a way that I've never experienced before, I want to walk with you. Hallelujah. And power. Lord, may the things of this world become dim in my eyes where I no longer I'm concerned about the things that don't matter. But Lord, come in power into my life. Lord, I'm so hungry for you. Lord, move in my family, in me personally, in this house. Lord, I'm asking, create in me a hunger that normal, dead, and dry liturgical religion can't fill. Lord, make the things that are man-made a stench to me where I can't even stand the smell, the spiritual smell of dead religion. Hallelujah. Lord, across this place, there's hungry hearts that want to be renewed in the power of the Spirit of God. Lord, renew this morning. Baptize afresh and anew. Some for the first time. Lord, I'm so hungry. You said, I'm so hungry. The word of God still declares that blessed are those which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Lord, I pray for fresh rain. Lord, let the fire fall again across this house. Hallelujah. Can we take just a moment to worship? How about, oh, come, let us adore Him. Sing it from your heart. It's not just a Christmas song. Listen, it's an ultimate worship song. Can you sing it?
Oh, come let us adore.
Come on, church, sing it.
Oh, come let us adore.
First time you've ever really considered adoring Him this morning as an act of worship, sing it.
Oh, come let us adore Him.
He's worthy.
Oh, come let us adore Him. Oh, come let us adore Him, Christ.
Just voices, sing it.
Oh, come let us
sing it.
Adore Him. Oh, come let us adore Him. Oh, come let us adore Him, Christ
the Lord. Same way, you alone.
For you alone are worthy.
So worthy.
For you alone are worthy. For you alone are worthy.
Sing it.
We'll sing choir. choirs of angels singing exaltation. Oh, sing all ye citizens of heaven.
Sing it, glory to God. Just a second. Hallelujah. Oh, come. Quietly, oh, come. Quietly.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and trust.
I'm still a God of power, and I'm still a God of life. I have not changed. I still dwell among a people that'll lift me up. I still walk with a people that'll walk with me. I still am the God that dwelt among the wings of the cherubim in power. I'm still the same. What I've done before, I will do again. If a people will cry out to me, I'm still the same. Praise your name. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name. Thank you. praise your name. Hallelujah. If you're in a position that you need to slide out quietly, if that's where you're at, that's fine. It's just 12:06. But he's still in the house. Praise your name. Sing it again. For you alone are worthy.
For you alone are worthy. For you alone are worthy. For you alone are worthy.
Need a physical touch in your body this morning. I believe there's someone here, at least one, that needs a miraculous physical touch in their body. I believe we're in that atmosphere where the Lord can touch and heal.
Born the King of Angels.
Church, can you do me before you walk off? There's a man in Hollenwald, Tennessee. You don't know him. His name is Billy Meek. Billy Meek is a pastor who has been through more than I've seen most ever go through. The last 2 months, his kidneys have begun to fail. He's not an old guy. He's about my age, and that makes him not an old guy. His kidneys have begun to fail. His wife has leukemia that's not responding to chemo at this point. 2 weeks ago, well, about a month ago, Billy's body just began to go haywire, and he ended up in a facility because he couldn't walk. His kidneys were failing. At one point, they took 60. Now, listen to the number I'm about to tell you. They took 65 pounds of fluid off of Billy about a month ago. And then him and his wife both ended up with COVID in this condition, both in the same hospital at the same time. And his daughter had put on Facebook that we're entering the dark days where my dad's going to go home, and he's not been responsive for days, and they said they've done all they can do, and he's not going to make it. Mom's in the hospital down the hall with COVID, fighting leukemia. And somehow, some way, the very next morning, Billy woke up in his right mind. He even testified that he was at a point where a nurse had leaned down in his ear and said, "You're going home. You're on your way home." He said, "I remember it. You're leaving." And he said, "I was even in a place where I knew that I was leaving my body, and then all of a sudden I was just back." He said he has stories to tell he hadn't told. But I read just this morning where Billy, his health is improving and his mind is clear, but he still can't stand. He can't stand on his feet. His wife still needs prayer too. Their name is Billy and Pam Meek, and they're in Hollenwald, Tennessee, and they're great pastors. They're great people. Can we lift up Billy and Pam Meek this morning from Marysville, Texas? Is that all right? Lord, we lift him up to you this morning. You know right where he's at. You know where Pam's at. Lord, thank you for keeping their church together. Lord, for holding that family of believers together, Lord. But this morning we just pray specifically for Billy to be able to bear the weight of his body on his legs. Lord, that you would put him on his feet and return strength where he can function and walk and continue in the ministry that you've entrusted him with. Lord, that everything that comes against his physical body, Lord, that comes back into order even now. Lord, we lift up Pam to you too. Lord, you're bigger than leukemia, even stubborn leukemia that doesn't want to turn loose. Lord, these are choice servants, great pastors, doing a great work. You've brought them a long way. They influence their community heavily, Lord. Raise them back up physically this morning. Lord, we bring Jackie Rogers to you this morning as well. Thank you for his healing and continued strengthening of his body. Thank you for a successful surgery. Lord, that you would bring him back to full. We pray for Mike Cerny this morning, who is not feeling well this week, that you would touch his body, raise him up. Lord, thank you for what you've done in Dan Hudson. And Lord, that you're continuing to put strength in him and returning him to fullness that he was created for. Lord, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name across this place. We're going to obey. He says he's mighty to save. If you got lost loved ones this morning, call their name. Lord, this morning, all across this place, it's not just a form and a ritual, Lord, that we take it seriously, that you can call your people home to their place at their Father's house. Lord, we lift up names all across this building, prodigals and lost loved ones, children, parents, grandparents, nieces, nephews, friends, loved ones. Lord, that you would call them to a saving knowledge of you. Lord, a miraculous change. It's always a miraculous change, but a dramatic reversal, repentance in hearts and lives we call today. Children that we thought would never turn, Lord, let them return. Let them turn and return in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We want to pray for Glenn. I guess Glenn's out. Let's lift up Glenn this morning, Glenn Pitt. Can we lift him up this morning? If you're right around Glenda, stretch your hands towards her. Lord, we believe you right now in the name of Jesus for Glenn Pitt. He's on the property, Lord. You know right where he's at. Lord, touch his body right where he's at. Give him strength, Lord. Lord, a miraculous healing power of God again. Lord, strengthen Glenda. Lord, build their faith even now. But Lord, above all that, just do the work, because we believe you can and we believe you will touch and heal and move in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Up Dr. Julius Deverini this morning. Neurologist, right? Neurologist. He's a man that's lost hope. He treats other people, tries to give hope through medicine. But he's a neurologist locally. And he's lost hope. He's got things going on in his body. He sees his hope as death, suicide, not hope in Jesus Christ, but just to end it. Can we lift? Is it okay at 12:20 if we lift him up this morning? Lord, you know right where he's at. You know right where he's at. You know right where he's at. Lord, he needs you. Lord, he's been steeped in religion all these years, but he needs to know you. Lord, reveal yourself to this doctor right where he's at. Touch his body. But Lord, heal his spirit. Lord, reveal yourself to this doctor. As he helps other people, Lord, help him. Help him reach him. Lord, we pray for Richard this morning and thank you that all the curse is reversed. Lord, we come against strokes and injury and neurology problems. Lord, that they stop in the name of Jesus. You've touched him before. You've healed him miraculously for what you've done once, you'll do again. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Do it again in Jesus' name. Eloy Castro is a pastor of COVID and cancer. We lift him up, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. Lift him up in the name of Jesus. Lord, you know. Lord, we are asking for you to intervene miraculously. that COVID has to die at its root in his body. And we curse cancer in the name of Jesus. Lord, that you give him, that you lengthen the days of his life. And that you enrich the reach of his ministry to touch hearts and lives with the healing testimony of Jesus Christ. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Kidneys, and we need as he grows for all of his urinary tract to grow and be normal with him. And we lift up Cain this morning in the name of Jesus. God, we believe you're a creative God, that you still do creative miracles. You know how his body should function, and Lord, we're asking you to call it in line with how it's intended to work. Lord, that everything within him, his urinary tract, would function normally and grow with him normally in the name of it. Lord, we're asking you for a miracle that astounds the doctors.
Yes.
Go ahead and document it in medicine, because it brings you glory. In Jesus' name. Each other in the name of Jesus. We're anticipating what God's going to do. In Jesus' name.